first presentation will be a quick introduction to query processing and Apache Calcite. And I'm going to present a few words about myself. So my name is Stamatis Zampetakis. I have been working in the broader area of data management for about 10 years, focusing mostly on graph databases and some part of it on multi-version databases. And currently I'm working as a software engineer at Cloudera, and I'm part of the Hive Optimizer team. So essentially I'm contributing to Apache Calcite and Apache Hive, mostly at Apache Hive at the moment. So just to give to set a bit of the expectations for the for this presentation, when I made this, it is tailored about students and newcomers to Apache Calcite. But I've seen that in the meetup, we have quite a few people that are very, very deep into Calcite themselves. So for those, I would like to ask that you keep notes that you can send me afterwards or even during the presentation, so that the next time that we present this to students, it will be much better than the current form. So please pay attention. I like to start my presentations with a bit of motivation. So why do I talk about query processing? Why it is important? Let's start with a very basic example. Like, we have a website that is selling books, and there is a system, and we as developers, we want to implement the following view, where we want to display the books, and for each book, so the image of the book, the title, the first name and last name of the author, as well as the price and additional details if necessary. Of course, usually the books appear in some order. They are not totally random. And let's consider for the simplicity of the example that it's ordered by ID, by book ID. Most interestingly, it would be to use by price or something different, but it's not relevant for the discussion. And then, because we cannot display millions or billions of books at the same time, let's say that we want to display only the top five. So with this in mind, the question comes to what kind of data do we have and where they are stored and how they are stored. So for simplicity, let's consider that we have a book and authors with a few attributes. And for each book, we have at most one author. Then a very naive solution would be to store them as they are in plain files, plain TXT, CSV, JSON, or whatever form in the file system directly. Of course, there are many, many data management systems that we can put our data in. And what changes is that depending on what we choose, we have so many options. So we have different APIs. Some systems provide full-fledged SQL, and some others simply get put operations or just read the file from the file system and do everything by hand. For our example, we are considering that we have an in-house system, which is a Java-based implementation of an in-memory store. Again, this is a toy example just to play with. So for this, we are assuming that we have a very simple API that gives us basically a list or a collection for each relation. So we have a list of authors and a list of books. So based on this, we would like to create our view of books that we talked to at the beginning. And let's assume that we have to implement this in Java. So I guess the question here would be, how do we do it? Well, the quickest thing that comes in mind is that start by iterating through the books. Then for each book, find the author that corresponds to each book, add it to the result. And also we have to account for the situation where we might not have an author for a specific book, it might be missing. So we don't want to prune out the book entirely from a view, but just display it without the author information. After we've done this, we are going to sort our data based on the book ID. and then keep only the top five, so the sub list from zero to the limit. It's not really necessary to go through each line of the code and understand what happens. I may have bugs also, since I made it quickly, but I want to give you the general idea here. What we can notice is directly is that operations can be reordered. So instead of doing the limit and sort at the end, we could do it directly after scanning the books. So we move it here, and this we can save CPU when we pass and we do the and we try to fetch the authors. The second observation is that operations, so combining books with authors, can be implemented differently. In the first case, we had a nested for loop, and now we are putting every author in a hash map, and then we're performing a lookup in this hash table, in the hash map, to find that the authors that corresponds to a book. Then if the implementers of our backend, the BookDB, are kind with us, instead of giving us just a single way to access the data as a list, they would be kind to provide us an index-like structure, like a tree map, where we have every book ordered by ID. So in that case, we could start by iterating through the tree map in order of a book ID and only keep the first five books. So directly we can skip the entire collection of books, almost the entire collection of books, speeding up quite significantly the performance of our algorithm. So summing up, I would like to ask you which of the three implementations would you choose? And given that it's not easy to provide an answer, actually it's easy to provide an answer, but due to have a non-interactive Zoom session, I will give you the answer directly. So the answer is none of the above. If we want the system to be functional for more than a few weeks, we shouldn't pick any of the three implementations, but enlarge our scope and think outside of the box, let's say. What we have seen is that we have a common goal, a common description, and different implementations. So instead of using an imperative language and describing what we want to do, we want to have a declarative query language like SQL, for instance, where we describe what we want to do and not how do we want to do it. Then along with the Java code that we've seen previously, on the right, we had some boxes. So the general observations is that we have operations that be combined together. And this is a quite well-known concept in data management. This is a relational algebra. It's very old, and it's very good to use it because it has a solid mathematical background and we can perform many optimizations due to this. So we need to use algebraic operators. Last, in order to choose among the different options, we have to use a query optimizer. So somebody has to look into all these possibilities and take a decision. So all of this boiled down to a query processor. So basically, instead of naively implementing our Java-based method, our Java API for the view, we are going to implement a query processor. And what is a query processor? I guess most of you are familiar with it. Everything starts with a query. In this case, we are talking about SQL, so it's an SQL query. That it goes through the parser, and then we get an operator tree, like the one that we've seen previously. Most often, this is called a logical plan because we cannot execute it directly. Then the plan goes through the optimizer or planner, and based on some kind of rules, the operations are going to be reordered, and we are going to choose some implementation algorithms for our logical operations. And this will give us another operator tree, another plan, that we can pass to the execution engine and get back our results. Of course, to do all this, we need some kind of interaction with a catalog reader and the schema information. So when we build our queries, we know that they are valid queries, and our tables relations that we are searching for do exist in the system. Of course, you are going to say like, okay, the Java implementation would take us 30 minutes or 1 hour or at most a day. Why do we need to build a query processor for that? And how much time will take us? I guess it will take us months or even years. Where this is where Calcite comes. Actually, with Calcite, Calcite provides all these components that are necessary for building a query processor from scratch very quickly. So the architecture of Apache Calcite, at least the query processing part, looks a bit like this. So we start with the SQL query that it grows through the parser, and then we obtain the abstract syntax tree, and another kind of tree representation, which is based on the SQL node interface. There, using the validator, we can verify that the arguments to functions are the types are correct. We can verify that the tables do exist in our schema that we can see on the right. So we have an interaction with the catalog reader that we provide, and we obtain a valid abstract syntax tree, another SQL node. Then this SQL node, this tree, goes through the SQL to relational converter, SQL to rel converter, and we have our operator tree, our relational algebra expression. So at this level, we have a logical plan, let's say. Then we have the planner, where we can plug in rules and metadata in order to explore the search space. We have many built-in rules, and usually there is also the option for users to implement their own. And with metadata, what we mean is statistics. One kind of metadata is statistics, like how many rows exist in these relations, or what kind of constraints do we have for this kind of relation. Taking this information into account, we obtain the physical plan, so another rel node, another operator tree, that we can execute by passing it to the rel runner or to another execution engine. And finally, we obtain our results. So let me just quickly now show you an end-to-end. Before that, usually what the users have to do, where the clients of Calcite what to do, is implement some kind of extensions to implement the BookDB, let's say, the database system. And usually these extensions come mostly in terms of new rules. So in terms of relocked rules here on the left, or new metadata. And usually it comes with additional physical operators. Needless to say is that normally you have to provide the execution engine, so kind of a rel runner. And of course you have to provide the schema, because without the schema, you cannot run your queries. So with the query that describes our use case, we start with the SQL query, and then we build the AST, so the SQL node. Here we have roughly a one-to-one correspondence between our clauses in the SQL and the SQL tree. So here we have the book ID that we can see this identifier here. We have the limit that we can see it here. And every identifier in the select clause, we can see it in the tree. So basically we have an in-memory tree representation of the SQL string that we can easier manipulate. Still, we are not yet to relational algebra. So after this AST passes through the validator and we obtain another AST, as it's shown with quite a few simplifications on the left. So imagine that here we have the complicated things that I showed you in the previous slide. So from this complex, let's say, or more complex representation, we pass through the SQL converter and we get our algebraic operators, our relational algebra expression, or in other words, our logical plan. And this is much simpler and much easier to optimize, since it's based on, it has a mathematical background, and there are many rules that are proven that work. And actually, these rules, many of these rules, are already implemented in Calcite, so you can use it without any effort. One such rule is a filter into join rule, where we can exchange the filter that appears on top of the join and push it right below of the join. Usually, this can improve the performance because we skip, we prune data that are not necessary for the final result. And then we have many rules that go from a logical operator to a physical operator. So here we kind of choose the implementation algorithm. So we have a one-to-one correspondence. From a logical sort, we use a bindable sort rule and we go to a bindable sort. So after we have all these things in place, we have our physical plan that we can execute and get back our results. Let me just check in terms of time how I'm doing. Yes, okay. So just to close up a bit the presentation before going to the coding demonstration, is that Calcite already is used by many, many systems, open source or not, like, for example, Apache Flink, Apache Drill, Apache Hive. The optimizer is their optimizer is based on Calcite. And apart from that, Calcite can be used to provide an SQL interface over engines that do not provide SQL capabilities, like, for example, Redis. Redis is a key value store, and Calcite has already an adapter that can connect to Redis, and you can perform joins without using, yes, you can perform joins directly. So let's put a bit all of this in practice and see how we can implement our fictionary BookDB system in a few minutes. So I hope the screen and the code is visible. So in this thing, in this class, I don't have anything particular. I just have some data and some other small stuff on the topo. So it's less than 100 lines. And we are going to do it most of the things from scratch starting from now. So
Mati, we cannot see the code. We only see the slides.
Ah, okay.
Probably need to switch.
Good point. Stop, sorry. Let me share the other window. Is it fine now?
Looks good, yeah.
Okay, so we start, the first thing that we need is a type factory in order to create the our data types. After we have the factory ready, and we are using a Java factory in this case, based on Java types, we want to create our schema. So to do this, we create a schema that we, let's say that we don't want metadata tables, so that's why we put false here. And we start creating the data types for our book table. So we use the type factory for this, and we start creating the attributes. So we have the ID, that is the ID of the author, which is of type integer. Then we have, let's say, the first name, which is of type varchar. And goes on with last name. And I guess that's all for the specific example. and we have to build our type. Then after we have done this, we need actually to create our table. So since we said that we have a Java-based list implementation, we're going to use an abstraction that is capable of reading from Java lists. So we pass two things. We pass the data type and our data. Again, this is a very simplistic example. What is worth noting at this point is that our table, the definition of our table, does not have a name because the name is part of the schema. So when we add our table to the schema, we provide its name. So in this case, we named our table author. And what we can do is we can put the same table multiple times with a different name. So we have access to the same data, but under a different name, let's say AR. And we, when we pose our queries, we can use this information. So it's an like an alias. And now we have to do the same thing for the book table. So we have to start with the type. Then we have an ID, title, year of publication. And we have an additional attribute, which is the ID of the author, since we are pointing towards the author. So after we have our type, again, we do the same thing. We create our book table. We put the data in. And we add the book table to the schema with the name that we desire. Now we are fine with the declaration of the schema. So we are starting to handle the query processor part. So everything starts with the query parse, the SQL parser that is created once for each query. So let's start with a simple query that says select ID from book or select title from book where ID equals or greater than one. So here we have our parser and we can obtain the first not validated AST. So at this point, we can try to run it and see if it parses correctly or if I did a mistake so far. Normally it should be faster. I don't know why it's taking time now. Anyways, I will wait a bit. So yes, our query parses successfully and we have like the two string representation of our AST. Now notice that if I do a mistake here and I mistype the select and I try to rerun the query, what as you can imagine, what will happen is that we are going to get a parse exception. On the contrary, if I mistype an identifier and instead of title, I say type, for instance, then I will not get an error. So the query still parses successfully. So whose job is to verify that identifiers are correct or types are correct? So this is the job of the validator. So here we are going to create our validator. And I'm starting by specifying what kind of operators are allowed. So I'm putting the standard SQL operators. then I need a catalog reader to have access to schema information. And I need also a type factory because I may need to create types or validate types. And then I use the default validator configuration for the moment. So then, as I said, we need a catalog reader. So let's instantiate one. So the catalog reader needs to have the schema that we built before. And it needs to have which is the default one, because we may have sub-schemas. In this case, we don't have sub-schemas, so it suffices to pass an empty list. Then it misses, what else? Let me check, I kind of forget. So we need a type factory and a configuration. So we pass a type factory and a default configuration. So after we have all this in place, we can validate our AST. And now normally we should see if it is, if we get kind of errors or not. So let's print it also to see if it works. And if we see, it says that it parses correctly, but it says that object book not found. Did you mean book? So the validation passed successfully, but what happens is that it cannot find the book because it's case sensitive. So what we need to do is in our configuration, we need to specify that we want it to be case insensitive. So we set case sensitivity to false in this case. So with this in place, I think it should pass the validation. But if it doesn't, I will have to do it again. So now we have a valid AST at this point. Next step is to get it to create the relational algebra expression. So we need to instantiate an SQL to left converter. Here we have to pass quite a few parameters. The first one is a view expander. So if our schema contains views, then we have to implement one. But given that in this example, we didn't talk about views, I will ignore it. So I pass a nope expander. Then we pass the validator, catalog reader, type factory, if I remember correctly. Category there, a cluster, converter table. Okay. So we have a cluster. And some default configuration also for the converter. And what we seem to miss here is the cluster. So I will not get you into details about this, but the optimization cluster, the RELOP cluster, is a data structure that is used during the whole optimization process to keep state. So the state is kept in the cluster. So we use it all over, in the planner, in the converter, in many, in many other places. So now we have the SQL to converter ready. And one thing that I would like to explain here that I didn't talk about is the converted table. I cannot spell it, I cannot pronounce it correctly. Which what actually does is take some expressions and transforms them to a canonical form so that we don't do the same effort twice. For instance, if we have the coalesce operator, we will this convertlet will transform it to a case expression so that we don't have to implement again a different logic in all over the place, in all over Calcite, just for coalesce itself. So now we have the converter and we have to pass our validated node. We supply false because the node is already validated. And we say that it's a top level query. So we pass top here. So here we should have our logical plan, let's say. And we can try to print this out so that we see how it looks. Let me try to run this. So if we check, here is our algebraic expression. So we didn't have anything fancy, just a table scan, a filter, and a projection. Then we want to get this and transform it to a physical plan that we can actually execute. So we need to get our planner, our optimizer, and this is already present in the cluster. And we have to pass the rules that we would like to use. So for to begin with, we are going to use just the implementation rules. So we are going to use a table scan. So this rule transforms a logical table scan to a bindable table scan. Then another rule for the filter. And another one for the project. With this in place, we should be able to get a physical implementation. But to do that, we have to tell the planner what is the kind of physical plan that you would like. And this is a kind of a more complex notion in Calcite, the notion of convention. And in general, the traits. So this deserves a bit more discussion so I can answer questions afterwards. But what we want to do here is that for our logical plan, we want to say that we want it to be the resulting plan. We want it to be in the bindable convention. So a physical implementation that relies on bindable operators. And this, with this, we are changing the requested convention. We are setting the plan to optimize in the planner, and we are ready to go for the optimization process. So it suffices to call find best to get our physical plan. Let's try to display it also. Okay, and here I will try to execute this. And we successfully went from logical operators to physical operators or to bindable convention. Then the last part, the last missing part is actually executed. And with the bindable convention, it's quite easy. So let me just cast the physical plan into bindable operator, since we know that it's going to be of this type. And let's see if we get back our results. So as I said, the bindable convention gives us back results in object arrays. Each row is an object array. So we take our physical plan, we bind it to a context. In this case, the context is only schema information. It has nothing more. And then we are ready to go. I'm careful because many times today I managed to switch off my computer by pressing Control Alt Delete or Control Alt Backspace. So I don't want to do it right now. And as you can see, we got back the results. So we got back the four books that satisfy the filtering condition. So our data are here, as you can see. And we are filtering based on the ID. So we got back everything like that. Then, of course, we can do more complicated queries. I will just, I have a minute or so. So let me take a query that I have ready. And pass it here. And if I run it directly, it will fail during planning. So you get a very common error when you start building applications with Calcite that there are not enough rules to produce a node with the desired properties. So this is easily fixed in this case because we added more operators, actually. So we have to add some operators to perform the join. And what else? And the sort. So we kind of missed two rules. With this in place, let's try to see if we get back our result. And you can see that the plan changed. So we have the same one that we seen in the presentation previously, as kind of book and author, the join condition, a left outer join, the filter condition on top, followed by a sort and limit. And our results, of course, that satisfy this condition. And as we said, Calcite already offers many built-in rules. So you can use, for example, the filtering to join rule. And then what we want to see is that the filter, the optimizer will judge that the filter, it's better to push it below the join if possible. So if we run this, then we should get the filter below the join. So in a bit more than 15 minutes, we have a full-fledged query processor. So I find this very, very cool. And I love Calcite due to that, because it saved me quite some effort. And given that here we are talking about a system that's totally fictionary, but the same principles apply to building any kind of system. You can put these components together and you have much flexibility. And the truth is that this is only a part of Calcite. We have a JDBC driver known as Avatica project, and we have also many other components that can be used. But given the time, I don't have much more to talk about now, but we could do it in follow-up meetups if there is interest. So many thanks for your time.